I'm going to go ahead and call the meeting to order at 5:04. And I don't have the agenda up, so somebody.
So the first item on the agenda is approving the legal ad for rezoning the Wendelowski parcel.
Do you know if he can do the 25th, Don?
If I can?
If Gary can.
I assume so. I haven't talked to him.
Well, we'd have to get it in to the paper by Thursday, I think. So, no, wait a minute.
It's a 2-week notice period.
It's 3 weeks. It really takes, it winds up being 3 weeks. Yeah, and they used, they used to squeak them in for you, but they're not doing that anymore.
Okay, so you have to get it in by Thursday for, to publish on next Tuesday?
Next Tuesday.
The next meeting on the 24th.
You would want me to publish it on Tuesday, the what?
The 11th. I think it's the 25th, isn't it, Don?
Yeah, right.
Meeting on
the 11th and the 18th. So basically, really, we really need to get it in by, you said, tomorrow or Thursday, right?
Yes, tomorrow would be even better. They're shorthanded there now too. So,
well, I think even if he can't make it, we've already approved this once, so we can do it again.
Well, he should. Well, there were some issues with the abutters at the town meeting. Well, I wouldn't say issues, questions. So maybe you could call him tonight, Don, or tomorrow morning. And let me and Mary know.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll do it as soon as we finish the meeting.
You all got a copy of the draft, so.
Yes.
And nobody indicated any problems.
It looked just fine to me. I'm just
on the explanation page, right, or on the one that's posted on the town website, I added where to look for the uses and the table of use, which I think might help. Mm-hmm. And those, it's embarrassing. We'd never done that before.
And you've confirmed, Judy, that those page numbers are accurate on the latest version of the bylaws?
I was working from online, so I assume so, but.
All right, well, looks to me. So the table of use looks like in my paper copy runs from arguably page 6 is the first page.
It's just the commercial uses they need to.
I see, just the commercial uses. Okay.
And I sent them to the web anyway, so
yeah,
it starts on page eight.
That's right, very good. I see pages 8 and 9, and then it turns into light industrial. So that looks good. Okay. So do we need a formal vote to approve this, or just a discussion?
No, we, as long as everybody agrees, we normally just do this by a email.
Okay.
We're still talking about approving the ad?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, scheduling the public hearing, I think, is technically the topic.
Okay.
This is scheduling rather than approving that, Mary.
Okay.
And so we're scheduling the public hearing for our next regular meeting on January 25th, Tuesday.
Yeah.
Do we need to set a time?
It's on the ad for 5:15.
5:15.
Okay.
Now, while we're doing public hearings, maybe we should do the 149 State Road discussion. And that's
149 Christian?
Why did I put State Road? Christian Lane.
Okay, very good. So Julie's here.
We're going to have the same problem. If it has to be in on Thursday to make the 25th, we're not going to know about the public hearing. We're not going to know about the special permit till Thursday night. So maybe we should just schedule it for the 25th. And then if they don't get the special permit, we can cancel it or we can pull it.
Yeah. I think that makes sense.
If the meeting continues, we can just continue the public hearing.
I just have a question. I see Mike out there. Just one second. So Julie, your Green Jeans Farms would be able to participate in a public hearing on January 25th. Is that correct?
Yep, that's right.
Okay.
All right. I put it on in the draft ad. I put it at 5:35 on the assumption that 20 minutes would be enough for State Road. I'm not sure
everybody agrees. Okay.
That's probably something that should be discussed.
Okay. Mike, did you have something to say?
Yes, I did. I had a question. Are we talking about 149 State Road, which is listed on the agenda for tonight's meeting? Or are we talking about 139 Christian Lane, which is not listed on tonight's agenda? 149.
So
I'm looking at a copy. Looking at a copy.
Oh, there is a mistake. There is a mistake in the agenda that we all missed. Thank you, Mike, for pointing that out. The agenda says 149 State Road. It should have said 149 Christian Lane.
I'm wondering if there's any other people that would not be on this evening because of that.
I don't think we would normally not do this at a public meeting. We normally just arrange these by email. So I don't think the actual date is of enormous consequence. It's our next regular meeting.
Yeah, so we were not going to do a public hearing about any marijuana facilities tonight. We were only going to discuss scheduling one, in particular the Green Jeans Farms one. So for your benefit, Mike, the game plan is Green Jeans Farms at 149 Christian Lane will have a public hearing on Tuesday, January 25th. But it's contingent. There's a ZBA, Zoning Board of Appeals meeting on Thursday that is going to address, and we are expecting that the Zoning Board of Appeals will tell Green Jeans whether or not they will issue them a special permit. And if for some reason there is no special permit issued by ZBA, then that creates some contingencies around the Planning Board's review of Green Jeans Farms. Does that make sense?
Okay, I'm just trying to understand the procedural aspect of all of these meetings as I'm fairly new to this. So thank you for the explanation.
You're welcome. Okay. This just goes to show even after multiple eyes reviewing a document, we can still get some addresses confused. Okay,
Mike. So I also will contact. I forgot the name of the company that they for across the street and see what's going on with those trees.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the Nexamp property.
Nexamp, right.
Yeah.
And you're right, they did not put in enough trees. There should have been one more further towards the west. They were supposed to be spaced out.
I don't think they put in any of the plantings on the west side of the property that were supposed to be there, did they?
No, this was along the road. It was supposed to be one further west than the three they put in, or two.
And then to make matters worse, they cut one down. So maybe
if you look at today's agenda on the Whately.org, there's the SVE, they call it the as-built plan, but I think it's as was supposed to be built, which is a good reference thing to have for Whately Renewables.
SVE. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Take a look at that. So are we closed with Wendelowski and Green Jeans Farms?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Very good. So the next item on the agenda is the corrected site plan review approval for Sovereign Builders. And if the chair would be willing, I'd like to do a little bit of table setting just for everyone's benefit.
You go right ahead, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Only the best silver now.
Yes. Okay. So to just refresh everyone's memory, the planning board had held a couple of public hearings or public hearing with a continuation. And in late June of 2021, we approved the site plan for Sovereign Builders, which is, that was on State Road. I just want to get it right. That was map 5, parcel 29. So we did that approval. However, subsequent to that meeting, the applicant, Sovereign Builders, became concerned, understandably so, that in their original application for site plan approval, which they submitted in February of 2021. In fact, maybe what I'll do if Sarah will allow me to, I can share my screen. Let me just share this one document for everyone's benefit. Okay. So when Sovereign Builders originally applied for a site plan approval review, which they did in February 23rd, 2021, under the brief description, they described it as a self-storage facility with three buildings totaling 28,600 square feet. Now, as the process unfolded and their plans were updated and revised along the way after this original application, so after February, but leading up to our meeting in late June, their plans had been revised, and in fact, the total square footage of their facility was greater than 28,600 feet. And so they're concerned that if we give them the signed approval for only 28,600 square feet, it would cause problems later. So we're not actually doing a whole new approval. Their plan has not changed in any meaningful way since, Chris Carney, you're here?
Hello.
Okay, and I'll give Chris Carney the floor in just a minute to share whatever he would like to share with the board. The sense is that the plan has not significantly changed since when we approved it. And really all we're going to do tonight is have a formal public meeting in which we update and approve revised site plan approval conditions that will reflect the increased and accurate square footage of the facility. All right, and I have a draft of what we would propose to vote on. In fact, what I'd like to do, Mr. Carney, is just put that up because it'll be new information to you. And I think it'll be important for all of us to look at that language and make sure we're comfortable with the language. So let me share that revised site plan conditions. Okay. So what I'm sharing here is the set of conditions. These highlighted conditions were all the original ones we approved in late June of 2021. What I've drafted and is subject to tweaking tonight is this new first condition. And I think Todd Salura is also on the call. Is that you, Todd, I see?
Sorry, I was having trouble with my iPad, so I'm on my phone.
Well, we hear you and see you just fine. A little small in the video, but all right. And so Todd's, I want to make sure that whatever this language is, that both we, the board, and you, the applicant, are comfortable with this proposed language. So what we're proposing to do is have a public discussion of these conditions. Actually, there's another question I want to ask Chris and Todd related to these conditions. But in particular, focusing on that first one, I've drafted this language based on the revised plan. We have received a revised plan from Sovereign Builders that makes very clear, in a way where it was previously implicit, what the total square footage of their three buildings will be. Because there are three buildings, two of the buildings are only one story high, and the third building is three stories. And so when you combine all the square footage of effectively five floors of buildings, you get the number that I put here. And so, let me pause there. Let me ask for any clarifications or updates from Chris and or Todd, then we can talk about this language. I have a particular question for Sovereign Builders. When I've added up all of the square feet of all of the floors, have I come to the same number that you believe to be the accurate number, 69,800 square feet?
What was the original number?
It was 20, let me just again look at this. It was in the original application page, it said 28,600 square feet.
So this is more than doubled.
Oh, yes.
Has the footprint of the three buildings changed?
No, the footprint of the buildings have not changed.
So the arithmetic on the original buildings was wrong, and this is just correcting the arithmetic.
It's actually just slightly, yes, that's correct. But the narrative in the submission was accurate on page 7, which that was been there since day one. But what was shown on the plan was that the 20,800 square foot of the proposed three-story building didn't stayed on at 20,800 square feet times three. So it was a little, although we all knew in the approval process that there was a three-story building, the square footage wasn't accurately, it needed to say three-story on the middle building. And that wasn't there.
So this is a I'm sharing now one of the pages of a revised electronic copy of their site plan. And it shows, let me just center on the three buildings. So the dark gray boxes are the three buildings. And they each show what their square footage is. And so this is just showing, this page is just showing the footprint. This is the page that I really wanted to show. So it's the same footprint, Tom, for the three buildings on the ground. The outlines of the dark gray areas remain the same from the original plan, but because the center building, the large one, is three stories, there's larger number of square feet.
So the new number captures the second and third floor of the large building.
That's correct.
All right.
Do you concur with that, Todd?
Absolutely. That's exactly as it is. Correct.
Okay.
All right. So a lot of people do not know what GFA is going to stand for on this.
Well, I'd love to walk you through these revisions if I could. Everything Brent said is very accurate, but also everything Todd had mentioned is also accurate. There were some discrepancies between the application and then the labeling on the plans are correct, but area can be viewed in a lot of different ways. On site plans, most engineering firms will label a footprint because we're generally dealing with stormwater. So we're looking at the amount of impervious area, not a building area. So our area was labeled as the footprint of the building, not gross floor area. GFA would stand for gross floor area. That would be the three floors combined. Very normal term for what we're talking about. But just to go back to the application, just to put everyone's mind at ease, that this is the same plan set and the same proposed project as before. I'm going to share my screen.
Let me stop sharing so you may.
So my point was that rather than put GFA in there, go ahead and write in gross square footage area.
I see, in the draft conditions.
Yep. Right.
So as part of the application, I'll just go through it real quick. Brant had shown this sheet, which does have an error of the 2860. This would be the footprint of the buildings for the original application. Then as we move down the narrative, you're gonna see that we propose the main building as 62,400 square feet, three-story building. So that was the original application for a three-story building in the middle. And then we did submit architectural plans as part of the submittal package. That clearly shows a three-story building, not a one-story building. So there is definitely some confusion with the area, but just to put everyone's mind at ease, this is the same project as proposed. Don, if the full write out of GFA is going to be a requirement, that can be done, but I would encourage you guys to just, GFA is a pretty standardized term, and in many towns, that's what they like to see on their plan set.
I heard Don really is recommending to, you know, me, to the planning board, that we spell out GFA in our conditions. That's all. Right. I don't think that, didn't interpret that as a request back to you for a revision of your site plan.
Understood, my fault. So really, I think that'll wrap it up. I would show you the same thing as before. And just in full disclosure, there were some revisions made to these plans since the last meeting we had. Those revisions were from MassDOT. They sent us some comments. They were all very minor. They really don't have much effect on you, but since the new decision will reference these revised site plans, I wanna make sure that the town of Whately has all the information and is aware of all the revisions that have been placed on this new plan set. So it's really the radius of the curb at the street has changed to 10 feet from 5 feet. That would be right here. The flares right here. To me, a very minor request, and that's driven by MassDOT. The next revision would also be shown right here. We had proposed a sign within the MassDOT right away. They would not let us put a sign in the MassDOT right away. That sign has been removed. So that's, a positive. The final revision would be, as you can see, the retaining wall does enter the state highway layout. MassDOT is going to require that the portion of the guardrail that's on top of the retaining wall is built to MassDOT standards. So you're going to notice the first 20 feet of this guardrail will be built out of metal, and then it could be an alternative material as it moves through the site. Those were the conditions requested from MassDOT, and those are the revisions that we would see on this site plan. And they're also going to be referenced in this title block here as DOT revisions. So I think that's going to wrap up all the revisions that were done from the last meeting till now, and hopefully clarified the issue that we had with the areas.
And you can confirm that four physical copies of these updated plans were delivered to the town offices, what, yesterday afternoon, is that correct?
Correct, yeah, Ms. Terry, former planner at City of Southwick, delivered them yesterday.
It okay. would be helpful if we had a digital copy as well.
We do have a digital copy.
Okay.
It's, good, thank it's, you. It's in our drive.
Good.
Okay, very good. All right. So I'm going to go back and reshare these site plan conditions. So before I make a motion to approve these revised site plan conditions, first of all, if I have any comments on this text from, say, Sovereign Builders or anybody on the board? We've been advised that if we sign the original application page as submitted and stamped with the error on the front page of where it says totaling 28,600 square feet, but we put these conditions on, you should be okay. Is that acceptable?
Brad, yeah, Brad, I would think I would feel better if the original signed application somehow had a on the second page where it's signed had a note that conditions were updated on 1/4/22 with a signature.
Okay. So what you're saying, well, first, so just before we attend to that, is this condition acceptable? In particular, Todd, I want to make sure it's acceptable to you, since you were concerned you couldn't use the approval paperwork to achieve ends that you wanted to achieve.
Unfortunately, I can't read it from.
I'll read it aloud. On your little phone. Yes, so it says, the self-storage facility shall consist of up to three buildings with combined gross, maybe combined is an unnecessary word, but it says with combined gross square footage of 69,800 square feet per the site plan dated February 23rd, 2021 and revised on December 16th, 2021. Just to make sure I added the bits about the dates so it's clear what we're talking about.
I would change it from combined to total.
Okay.
Oh, and gross floor area, possibly.
That's right. I think that makes sense. I do. Yeah, to add those.
So change combined to total and change gross square footage to gross floor area?
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah, that's a GFA.
I'll move that.
Okay, I second it.
I couldn't see the top of that. Could you just scroll up to the top of this document real quick?
So this is just a document we use internally to document the conditions that we agree on at these public meetings. And then either this document is printed, signed, and appended to the signed up, so the form that we return to the applicant, or sometimes we handwrite these conditions in. I think we're getting to doing more printing and attaching.
Looks very good, thank you.
Okay. I do, before we close on this, and we've had a motion that's been seconded, so we should have a vote. We should, if there's any other discussion before we vote. I defer to the chair.
All right. Hearing no other discussion, I'm call for a vote. Don, yes. Judy?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes.
Brant?
Yes.
Mara?
Yes.
Okay, the motion passes unanimously.
Okay. I do have a question back or a comment.
I have a question on the table, Brant.
Yes. Go ahead, Judy.
Well, I think that this, the original signature page of the site plan acceptance ought to have an annotation, handwritten is fine, that says conditions amended on January 4th, 2022.
So I'm just changing the share. So this is the original. Normally we would print out this page and we would add signatures and attach a page. So what is it specifically?
Well, we're, I assume that it was signed original. There's a signed copy somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I think that somewhere on this page, if you scroll down a bit, somewhere just in the right-hand corner, just a written notation that the conditions were amended by vote of the planning board on 1/4/22.
So we can handwrite that in maybe in this white, lower right-hand white space on the front page.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Don can initial it.
Yeah. Reference this, the 2,800 square feet above, saying that that's what was modified.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So Don and I will coordinate a time to join up at town offices and get this done. I do want to go back to the conditions, though, because it reminded me of something, and this is not about approving or not. But I noted here in the original conditions that the board requested submittal of the final stormwater management plan in electronic format. I know we've received physical copies of the final stormwater management report, but I don't seem to have any record of any electronic copies. So
I will send them out right now.
Okay, that'll be great.
I believe they were sent earlier, but I will resend them.
So if you send that to the planning board at whately.org email address, I'll be sure to grab that and save it in our files. And I did have a question. Since the board are looking at things about future, you know, periodic reports that we ask of applicants. First of all, I was looking at these last three conditions. So submittal of the construction soil sample reports, this would be done presumably later in the construction process. Is that correct, Chris?
Yes, all the inspections would be done during the construction process.
Okay, all right. And then these annual reporting requirements, it is our intent to be tracking all of those and following up periodically, sort of working with applicants to establish shared expectations around these reporting requirements and the timing of when such reports should be submitted. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
Was that a yes? Or?
Yeah, that makes sense to the applicant.
Okay, very good. Yeah, not trying to make, we're even trying to figure out, get clear among ourselves what we would minimally expect to see in these reports so that they're not unduly burdensome. Okay. So I think that's it on that agenda item. So the next agenda item is discussing the plan. So I guess, thank you, Sovereign Builders. I think Chris and Todd.
Thank you all for your time tonight. Much appreciated. This is great. It's a real relief to see this clarified.
We will plan within the next week or so, as we can get together physically in town hall and do all the stuff to get this paperwork done for you. And we'll notify you as soon as physical copies are ready, and we'll certainly get you electronic copies speedily.
Great.
All right. Thanks again. Have a great night.
Have a good night.
All right, bye now.
Bye-bye.
Okay, so the next agenda item is discussing planning board participation on the housing committee.
That's me. Hi, everyone. Hi. So I'm sure you guys all know, but I'll just refresh your memories. The town of Whately has received a $30,000 grant from the Massachusetts Department of Housing and Community Development in order to produce a housing production plan for the town of Whately. This is the first step in a series to kind of begin producing more housing in Whately. To that end, we are reestablishing the housing committee. And since this is an endeavor that will include a lot of planning efforts, I think that it would be really important to have some representation of the planning board on the housing committee. No need to make any decisions right now. Really, this is just an announcement saying we're reinvigorating the housing committee. I have a scope of work coming from FERCOG probably within the next couple weeks or so. I don't know exactly what the commitment will look like. I think that the scope of work will inform that more, and I'd be happy to send that to you as soon as we have it. So just wanted
Does
to let you know.
FERCOG is conducting the organizing the process, I guess.
FERCOG has more of the professional expertise, I think, that we need to actually write the housing production plan. So we will be consulting with them. So when we have more information, I'd be happy to send that along. It's just something to think about in the meantime. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to reach out to me. I'm communitydevelopment@whately.org. You can find me.
Well, before you go, are all the current members on the committee staying?
Yes. So I've received confirmation from Fred Orlowski, from Fred Barron. I think Catherine Walkowitz is also interested in participating. And besides that, we are still working on finding more members. I'm reaching out to
Richard Tilburg is not.
I haven't heard anything from Richard Tilburg. Okay. I reached out to him a few weeks ago. I might try again. And of course, we're reaching out to other boards and committees as well.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
Hannah, what's the driver for more housing in Whately?
So right now we're kind of working on, so that's an awesome question. We need to start producing some more housing in Whately, I think, especially affordable housing. The state set forth a goal for housing production. I can't remember the numbers off the top of my head, but Whately doesn't meet them yet. So this is kind of a step in that direction.
So it's just focusing on affordable housing.
I think affordable housing will factor largely in the housing production plan, but it's not solely affordable housing.
It could, for example, include accessory apartments and other things to just enable more people to live in their homes.
Right, exactly.
Good, thank you.
Okay. So the next item on our agenda was discussion.
You're assuming we don't want to discuss this. I don't know if that's true.
I don't know that I was assuming.
If we could get a volunteer now, then Hannah's life would be much simpler.
I mean, I don't expect anybody to volunteer themselves right now. That's not a pressure that I want to put on you if you don't.
Okay.
Yeah, but please feel free to reach out to me, and I'd be happy to talk to you about it more.
For what it's worth, I'd already been in touch with Brian about some other things like this, and the housing committee was something that looked like something I might be interested in. So
awesome.
We talked.
Okay.
So I would be following up with you about that, Hannah, unless there's another member of the planning board that has a particular passion that would override my own.
I think you're it then, Brent.
We'll be in touch, Hannah.
That sounds great. Thanks, Brent.
Okay. So next item on the agenda, unless there's further discussion about housing committee, is discussing possible bylaw changes for annual town meeting. So who's leading that discussion?
Well, I don't know about leading, but I was the one who suggested adding this, and I had two suggestions of things we ought to be evaluating. One is that I'm told that battery storage that's standalone, not necessarily tied to a solar facility, is increasingly common. And our bylaws do not contemplate that.
What do you mean by that? Like, for example, I have battery storage in my basement tied to my solar.
Commercial size. Commercial. Large scale. Commercial.
All right.
Not individual, although, you know, it might be that we need, when we first started researching battery storage for solar facilities, the only document we could find was one that Nicholas produced from New York State that had some really interesting rules about, or maybe application processes for individual solar facilities to guarantee safety and that kind of thing. But I don't think that's a zoning issue. I think that's maybe a Board of Health issue or something, or fire chief issue. But what I do think is if somebody wanted to plop a large scale battery storage and claim it's a utility or a business supply service, which is allowed in a commercial area or something, I don't know whether they could do it, but I do think it's, as usual, it's better to be prepared and have some standards and locations and setbacks and that kind of thing.
Judy, just so I understand a little better what we're talking about, if somebody did what you just described, where would the energy be coming from that they would store?
Probably it would come from, well, it could come from any place. They could just download it from the grid when there's
nothing. They would buy electricity somewhere and just want to keep it on their property so it's always available.
Well, it would be a commercial endeavor to smooth out power availability over a day's cycle.
It wouldn't be connected to any particular solar field. It's a regional resource as opposed to a battery storage for a specific field. Correct?
Yeah, as I understand it. Now, I am far from expert on this, but I think that they're building something like that in Hadley. But I gather it's with all of move towards alternative energy uses, they're all daytime generated and not necessarily at the time of the peak power use. So there's going to be a greater need. Now, whether this will ever show up in Whately, I don't know, but I think it's better to at least have given some thought to it. So that's number one on my list. And number two was marijuana delivery services. This has been allowed for a couple years. I didn't worry about it earlier because they said that the initial operators would only be those in impacted communities. And those are places like Springfield and New Bedford and the like that had drug occurrences or addictive occurrences. But they're kind of cropping up. And I don't even know whether we want these or not. I had thought that they would probably be allowed in the commercial use as a business service and supply service establishment till I reread that category today and discovered that those have to be conducted entirely within a building. But what I really am worried about is that I think it's an ideal business to qualify as a home occupation. All you need is a couple delivery trucks and a barn with a little storage area. And what I would like to do is to make sure we amend our home occupation bylaw so that it specifically prohibits any marijuana facility. But we also should probably be trying to decide whether we want to add a marijuana delivery service establishment to the table of use.
So I have a question. I'll preface the question by saying that the information I have is that this year, 2022, annual town meeting is scheduled for April 26th. So about 5 months off, or 4 months off. So what I'm hearing is really a discussion around board projects that might, so maybe one question is, since we've gotten used to annual town meeting happening in June versus April, if we're now going back to more like a normal schedule, are we targeting whatever new board projects we might pursue annual town meeting on this new schedule of late April? Do we have enough time to start something new and get through all the hearings and so forth in time for something to come up at an April town meeting?
Technically, yes. Especially if it's an easy one like amending the home occupation bylaw.
Okay.
But depending on the amount of research the marijuana delivery service, otherwise, we might want to request an opinion from town council whether he thinks it's allowed under our table of use. And if not, then we would have more time to work on something comprehensive. Although in that case, I think the state regulations are quite stringent about the way it has to be operated. And it's all packaged, and the normal issues like odor, mm-hmm. I don't think are a major issue. The battery one, I don't know if there's enough, if we could find that somebody in the area or maybe FERCOG or somebody would know if another town has spent a lot of time researching this. Mm-hmm. We might be able to do that fairly quickly. If not, that may have to wait. I don't think there's time to do a lot of research on it.
Right.
Huh. Now were interested in modifying the solar bylaw. For mixed use.
Who was that?
You read the column in the paper about...
Oh, I'm sorry, that's right. Sorry, I'm still bemused about the two things. There was a recent article in the Gazette about utility scale solar fields on farmlands being... modified in such a way that there could be more agricultural usage underneath the panels, or making the panels higher, doing other things to allow shade or light in different ways to reach the ground underneath. And it simply made me wonder whether it would be worth looking at our existing bylaws and learning a little bit more about agricultural solar to see whether our bylaws are welcoming to that, should be, and I think it really gets to the general question of when does the planning board take these kinds of initiatives? I think, Judy, the one about, and I was sort of pondering the issue around marijuana delivery. So how would we find out how our community, I mean, is the idea that we decide amongst ourselves as planning board members what we think the community wants in terms of amendments related to, say, allowing or disallowing marijuana delivery services as home occupations, and kind of throw that spaghetti against the wall in public hearings and see if anyone objects? Or should we be doing sort of gathering more advice or input from the community? I don't have an answer to this, but I'm just sort of, this is the first time I've been confronted with the planning board initiating something in the absence of a sort of a clearly identified problem. Maybe if you articulated what you think the problem might be related to home delivery services, then I might understand. Because I think the discussion we're trying to have is where should the planning board be investing energy? And I suppose part of that is if any member of the planning board has a particular, you know, cause or idea they want to pursue, they're free to research that and bring their suggestions to the board like any citizen could.
Well, I've always taken the position that our huge pay level is so that we can be alert to things that are needed to protect the town in case somebody wanted to put it here. Mm-hmm. And that if we go through the process as outlined, which calls for general discussions, public hearings, vote at town meeting, and where we have a select board that wants these votes to happen at annual town meeting, when there's a goodly body of people there, that we get a good sense of what people want and don't want, mm-hmm. and if we have done this correctly. And we try and do as balanced an approach as we can. And I think the solar bylaw is a good example because we have written it as much as possible to encourage compatibility with farming. We don't require pollinator plantings under the panels. And when asked, for COG asked, why aren't you doing this? We'd like farming to be there if they wanted to. Mm-hmm. We allow higher panels than many towns do because to farm underneath, they need to be higher. So that's the way we have tried to encourage it. The specific issue with marijuana delivery and home occupation is that home occupation is by right. No special permit, no site plan review. Mm-hmm. So abutters get zero input.
And would the... Yeah, so what's the...
I mean, the intent, the whole intent of the home occupation bylaw is that you have a business that's kind of tucked away inside with a very small sign.
Right.
And it's invisible to the butters in the neighborhood. That might possibly happen with a cannabis delivery service, but yeah. I really strongly suspect that people would not like that next door to them.
Hmm. And I could imagine that I might be concerned if it were the cannabis were not under, you know, it secured in some way, just like if we had an AR-15 home delivery service. I would be concerned about anything harmful, potentially harmful or dangerous. But
well, that's maybe in how you word the exclusion. I was wondering about making any state or federal regulated delivery of any state or federal regulated substance, which would include alcohol or AR or guns or ammunition or something. But that's the kind of discussion you get into once you're drawing the bylaw.
So how do we move forward on this? It seems like there's, as a sort of a point of process, we can generate some ideas for things like that we as a board might pursue. Seems like there ought to be some kind of informal, I don't know.
That's
if I
what we're doing book. Here.
Yeah, but that would also entail ensuring that there's at least one person who's taking ownership of shepherding that particular project. Like right now, the only project I'm really aware of is the floodplain bylaw project. And I want to make sure that we shepherd that to a successful outcome at the April town meeting. So I wouldn't want to take on anything new if that put the floodplain bylaw project.
I think we were hoping not to have that at the April town meeting.
Oh, is that so? Okay.
My feeling about the marijuana delivery is that federal and state regulations are going to be stringent enough that I doubt that anyone would be allowed to do that as a home business.
Well, I can research that, or Hannah and I can. Mm-hmm. I think to date, Brant, I have speared every bylaw change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it's perfectly appropriate for any member of the planning board to propose new initiatives. And then it seems like there's at least a stage where we get from an informal discussion like this to a sketch or an outline of like what the issue is and how it might be addressed. And through a series of public meetings, socialize it first amongst ourselves and then the community. Yeah, I think that makes sense as a process.
Well, I would personally be quite loath to reopen the solar bylaw, which was a very painful and long and protracted negotiation between abutters and farmers and solar. Well, everybody wants solar, but you know, that was not easy.
Right.
And also in the current environment, the state is requiring mixed use for every land in Chapter 61A, which is farm or timber, so farm. So I don't think it's necessary. And we really have tried to build it in. The other two, I can work on, and I don't know how much time Hannah has. Maybe she can help.
Yeah, Judy, let's talk about that more when we're not in this meeting.
Yeah.
The other thing
I think the battery one may be just too complicated to get done in the time available.
Yeah, Brent, I think the thing about dual use, agricultural use in solar fields, that's certainly available to any farmer that would want to do it. But we've had zero interest actually from anybody who's proposed any of these things.
Yeah.
The truth is nobody likes it. The farmers hate it because it reduces their production too much. The only thing I know that anybody in Western Massachusetts has done is goats and sheep. Uh-huh. Which is what that guy did. Yeah. The abutters hate it because the panels are tall and more conspicuous. Mm-hmm. And the developers hate it because they can only use 50% of the land and the panels are more expensive. So which is, I think, one reason it's been very difficult to, to get used. Evidently, in Colorado, they're finding it helps conserve water. I think in some areas, that might be worth a lot. It's not. We have too much water here right now. So.
Yeah. I think if it ain't broke, don't fix it, so to speak, is a persuasive argument in a volunteer board to like not pursue something. And I think you've also made a really good case, Judy, that when we can anticipate problems, like if we think that home occupations and cannabis delivery as a home occupation is a looming problem, then we would be wise to try to anticipate that and address it.
The other possible bylaw change is that a number of changes have been made to the zoning map, which didn't go to any kind of hearing. FERCOG provided me with a 400-foot setback, and unfortunately, they included interstate highways. So those interstate highway setbacks for the AR1 have been removed because it's not a real zone. So there have been some incidental changes made that just needed to be made. And,
I think Don Lynn wants to just revote the whole map. And every incidental change that was made was correcting something that was actually voted and approved with a hearing.
That's not true, Judy.
Well, no, let me finish, because the problem was that we voted that AR1 would only apply to roads with public access, but the map didn't get changed and you corrected it back to what we voted. What the town voted. I mean, we could talk to Lynn or I guess Amy these days, but I don't think there's anything that you have put in there that wasn't.
We've also added water zones, the flood zones to it.
Yeah, well, we haven't voted that yet, so we can't. I mean, or we haven't had the public hearing yet.
Excuse me, apparently lost my connection for a bit. It's telling me my connection is unstable, and for a while everybody froze on my screen. The last thing I was around for was the conclusion of discussing agriculture underneath solar panels and the fact that nobody liked it. I got all of that, but there's the chunk after that. I don't know what was discussed.
Don is concerned that he has made some corrections to the zoning map that we might have to have public hearings to confirm. And I was stating that
Amy's happy with that. I'm happy to drop it.
Okay, well let's find out. But certainly the floodplain one, there will be a public hearing. And it hasn't changed yet, so.
All right, I'm all set with that then. Next thing, it looks like approval of minutes.
Yes, and there's a whole slew. I was catching up on what's posted, what's in draft. And so why don't we go from the oldest to the newest and see how much we can get through in the time remaining. That makes sense. And the first
there were two that we didn't look at that were submitted last time because I got them in too late for people to have read them. That was April 27th and May 11th. 27th. Excuse me. That was February 23rd was deferred.
Yeah.
And March 30th was deferred.
Right. So I, according to my records, I reviewed everything in all our meeting folders for 2021. and I found draft but non-final, non-posted minutes for the following meetings: February 23rd, March 30th, June 29th, July 27th, August 31st. I found minutes for September 28th in our meeting folder that are listed in the document as being drafted and approved by the planning board, but they aren't yet posted on the town.
No, there are a bunch that were approved that aren't posted yet, because, well, some of the ones I had needed to be changed, and they haven't, that's why they haven't been posted yet. There were a couple of meetings that I wasn't at also.
There's one meeting and Hannah did those minutes. And we have those.
There was another one. I think
I did a set of minutes somewhere.
Oh, Judy, yeah, did a set, Judy's. And I think, I don't know whether those were approved at the next meeting.
They were.
Wasn't that? June 29th was reviewed and was approved as corrected.
Uh-huh. It
hasn't been posted yet. July 27th was approved as corrected, but hasn't been posted yet. August 31st, that was approved as corrected. Uh-huh. September 28th was approved, period. But I have to make sure that it matches, that what I've got here matches OneDrive. Okay. October 26th, Hannah sent her draft minutes.
Yeah.
And I have a note that those were deferred to tonight's meeting, I guess, too.
I see. Okay.
For approval. So we've got February 20th.
February 23rd.
February 23rd hasn't been, I sent them, but you haven't discussed them yet. March 3rd, same thing.
Okay.
Hannah's from the October 26th meeting. And okay. I don't know whether Judy's that are in, I don't know, maybe one of the ones I read was Judy's, but.
Okay, so let's focus for the moment on February 23rd. I'll share my screen. This is in the OneDrive. This is the most recent version with corrections from both Judy and myself. And I made a few very minor corrections. I don't think there is anything significant here. Judy, this is the version, because Judy had recused herself from the meeting about LaSalle property. So she made corrections that are reflected in this document. My review of these minutes. Oh, so one correction or addition I made for your benefit, Mary, is down at the end where you asked for, this is about the Hannah property.
Mm-hmm.
I've identified for you the name of the file in our foldering system that you can use as your point of reference, but the date of that plan is March 29th. So I've added to this, what I'm showing you is I've made a few additional markups, and this version of the minutes is in the OneDrive folder for the February 23rd meeting.
So I just have to make sure that what I submit matches the OneDrive.
That's correct.
Yeah.
So you should accept, review and accept all the corrections from myself and from Judy.
If approved.
Yeah, if approved. So what, should I just move to approve these minutes and then we have a discussion, or do we keep discussing the minutes?
Sounds like you move to approve.
I move to approve the minutes of February 23rd.
I have a second.
Second.
Approve as amended.
Okay. Approve as amended.
Yeah.
Okay, is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all of those in favor, Don, yes. Judy?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes.
Brent?
Yes.
And Sarah?
Yes.
Okay, the motion is approved unanimously.
Okay. So then the next set of minutes is March 30th. Again, there were corrections made. I will show you and share these revised minutes. Also in OneDrive, as usual, Mary. So these have all of the edits that either Judy or I submitted. So I think I know, like just today, I here corrected Tony Wanseski's from SVC to SVE.
It's S-E-K. Yeah.
No, it is. I checked it, Judy. This is actually how it's spelled. When I look at his emails, it's once. Because I originally was changing it to S-E-C-K-I, and then I went back to his emails, and that's the correct spelling of his last name. Let me just see if there's anything else. Oh, there's this yellow piece that we didn't resolve about the conditions on the, so we probably need to.
I sent you a note, Mary.
Judy, I think you said, I was gonna make sure I had that.
I think
you said that something was lacking. There was some sort of thing that was lacking, and that's probably what that referred to.
The bylaw requires that the driveway not be, that the approval indicate that the driveway is not a public road and does not meet the standards of Whately's public roads.
That's right. That's what you said.
So section 171-11 is accessory uses.
That's where the common driveway is for some unknown reason.
Common driveway.
And when you know that, then you can stay on the planning board.
Oh, yes. Common driveway requirements can be found, Mary, within section 171-1.
Yeah, but I'm pretty sure that particular thing is part of it, that the conditions should reflect that bylaw requirement.
So Mary, do you have the information you need?
I'm just writing down what Judy's saying. I mean, I don't, am I, is it, are you saying it's in?
So here's the problem I have is that, and by the way, I think we received a copy of the environmental review of the Hannum property. And my initial skim of it suggests that there might be some difficulty ongoing with that project. But if we approved the common driveway and we owe Tony some documentation where we have to explicitly list the conditions. And so we need to be sure we have the conditions right for the common driveway versus just telling Mary to go look somewhere. And so let me see what I can see for that for Masterson Road. Yeah, so I have
No, I'm sorry, it wasn't the.
So whatever language appears here is language that we must write on and in a signed site plan approval for the common driveway. So we owe that to Tony. So we should get these conditions right, get the language right here and now. So.
Okay, it's paragraph 2. E2.
What page?
16, top of the page.
16, top of the page, paragraph 2.
Special permit shall state that the driveway is not a private road or a public road, that it does not meet the standards for a town road, and that at the if the driveway is ever petitioned to be accepted and maintained as a public way by the town, it must first be upgraded to the road standards required in the Whately subdivision regulations at the petitioner's expense.
Okay. So I think what you're saying is that, I'll put this in square brackets, insert as a condition the entire text of 171-11
E2.
I'm sorry, was
paragraph
it
E2?
E2. Yeah. E2, like that.
Yeah.
All right. So that when Don and I work to get this paperwork done, we write that provision down in its entirety.
Okay. How about if we just put in the road must conform to all regulations?
The driveway.
I think, Don, that covers it, but.
This makes it clearer?
Yeah, I'm not sure people would ever think to look to E2 as a regulation.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's a lot of, maybe Don, this is an example of one where we just type this all up. That's a lot of handwriting.
it should just say that we'll meet the special permit requirements of 171-11-E2 regarding.
Give me that language again, meet the special permit
requirements for common driveways in paragraph 171-11-E2.
Look good? I'm sharing my screen, right? You can see that?
Yep.
Okay. All right. And then 3 is a recorded easement shall be provided. Okay.
Did they provide a maintenance agreement? I think they did. It's a little late to ask. I mean, not a maintenance, well, yeah.
So I don't know, I'd have to dig around in the-
Never mind, we approved it.
Okay. All right, so Don, we have 2 things on our actions. One is sovereign builder paperwork and then Hannum driveway code. And now we have this document that'll tell us what needs to go on that paperwork. Okay. This is a point of my own ignorance, Judy, because I notice you've corrected this language in the minutes. So again, this pertains to what we were approving regarding the Hannum common driveway.
Yeah, that's actually called a common driveway special permit.
So the plan, I had ignorantly, it's been my ignorant understanding that only the ZBA issues special permits, But apparently the planning board can do common driveway special permits.
Common driveway and what we call side lot access, which is approval for access onto a parcel from other than its frontage.
Okay, thank you.
There are, and they occur so rarely that we often don't think about the extra provisions that obtain with a special permit approval as opposed to site plan review. Like everybody is supposed to participate in every meeting. It takes a super majority, not a majority. Mm-hmm. There are other things like that, but we do very few, and often the two come together.
Good. So I've updated the language here for you, Mary. Common driveway special permit instead of site plan.
Yeah. But back to the other.
I want to go back to that for a minute. This has not been responded to in well past the time, and it may be now have been accepted just because we have not responded, because we've way over, unless they ask us to hold off on this.
Well, is that true? We did have a meeting, we approved it, we didn't deliver the signed paperwork.
Right. So because we didn't deliver it, it became de facto approval.
Do you know, I don't know the time limits on special permit applications, Don.
Well, the same thing happened on the Scott property.
Yeah.
Could I talk to Lynn about that?
Well, maybe we should, again, take that outside of the meeting. And if there's no point in this actually completing the paperwork and giving it to Tony, then we won't. But we have to.
I suspect it might be that Tony would be happy to have it, actually. But
yeah. All okay. Right. I'll move on. Let me just see if there's anything else. Just for Mary's benefit, I did make a little stylistic change to this statement, just somehow a request being met with silence connotes.
That something. Does sound a little dramatic, doesn't it?
It did sound a little, yeah, like there were, you know, the torches were being lit.
Yes.
And I think I made a similar stylistic change for you later on, but nothing significant. And then there's this yellow piece here. Ah, yes. And so there's a yellow marked comment from you, Mary, under these proposed zoning bylaw changes. And I have directed you here in my comment to the proper file that has all
the revisions. It's in there, okay.
All right. So you now can find what you're looking for.
Thank you.
All right. And that's that. So I would move that we approve the minutes of the March 30th meeting as amended.
I'll second that. Any further discussion? Hearing none, we'll call a roll. Don, yes. Judy?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes.
Matt? Yes.
And Sarah?
Yes.
Okay. I'll make a note that. So we've done those two. And then did we wanna, we're on a roll here and it's only 6:30. We wanna look at Hannah's minutes from October 26th?
Yes.
Okay, let me pull those up for you. Okay, just one quick second. Have designated Hannah the secretary pro tem. Nicely done minutes. Okay, let me share those. Okay. All right, so these are the minutes. So I've gone through these and edited them. Judy, did you review these?
I didn't have any changes.
Okay. I just made a few. I made sure that Tom was listed as a member present up at the top because he was and appears later on. And I think there was, I think it was pretty straightforward.
Oh, that looks like me.
Yep, that looks like you. All right. I think I corrected that just to be what we were sending a letter about. The site plan's side setback variance request. So we weren't really waiving a site plan. And I think that's it. I think Hannah pretty much got it all. So I will move that we approve the minutes of our October 26, 2021 meeting as amended.
I have a second.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a roll call. Don, yes. Sarah?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes.
Brant?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Okay. So now, according to my records, minutes that are we're still waiting on, aside from things that we have approved and are in process of being finalized for posting.
There are two from this year that haven't been written yet, April 27th and May 11th.
Right. And what about December 7th?
December 7th.
We did meet, didn't we meet on December 7th?
I'll have to look.
We did have a meeting on December 7th. There were minutes.
Oh yes. Yes, there are three. Right. Last month's meetings minutes are not written yet either. They're started, but so that's three from 2021.
Okay. All right.
April, May, and last month's minutes.
Okay. So your goal is to have those.
I will get them out within the month. We'll have them in time for the next meeting.
Yeah.
All three of them.
Okay. And I guess all the ones that now have been approved, you'll have finalized. Like, what's a reasonable time frame to get approved minutes finalized and posted?
Next week, I'll get them all corrected as they were approved, as amended, and send them in for, posting next week.
Okay, that sounds great. All right. So let's see where we are in the agenda, Don.
All items, I think we've kind of squeezed those in.
Yeah.
Anybody else care? Anything?
What about the 2023 budget?
Oh, yeah. There's the 2023 budget. And I suppose if we needed to talk at all about the whole landscape screening, tree cutting thing at 139 Christian Lane, the NEXAMP. Why don't we start with the budget piece?
Actually, Brant, you and I can take care of that. Whole committee. We'll just take a look at what we see if we need more.
So why don't I get in touch with you? Okay.
Mary, does it look like we're being billed for postage or stationery or anything. When you do letters for abutters and that kind of thing, do they go out from the town?
Actually, I used to buy them and submit receipts for them. I haven't done that lately. I just buy them and use them. I print labels that have the town's address on them. I don't really have an explanation for that, but what I need is to get Lynn to order me some more.
Wouldn't it just be easier to drop them off at town offices and have them send them out? Or make copies there? And
the thing is, I do it pretty much at home.
Okay.
And I'm never in Whately. I drop them off at the post offices north and east of you.
Why don't you?
It never even occurred to me to do that, to tell you the truth, because I'm never over there. And for a while, I did get pre-printed ones that Lynn ordered for me that said zoning board and planning board on them. And that worked pretty well, because I think I can't remember if the postage was on there or not, but I figured I would get around to asking for more of those.
So are you submitting receipts for paper?
No, I haven't been. It hasn't been included.
Well, could you add up how much you have spent? Because I think they're going to have a hard time trying to come up with a budget for next year if they don't know what the spending is.
Okay, I'll figure out like an average of how many abutters and all of that normally get all these things.
Well, you just sort of.
The problem is that because they haven't been submitted, we've got nothing.
I know. I understand that.
Let me
apologize.
Talk to Amy about this and see what we can do.
The other thing I'm not quite sure I understand is where the legal ads show up on our budget, because they're not there. There's a category there for advertising, but
well, the legal ads now get paid by the applicants. Well,
if they do, if they're for a site plan review, they don't. Yeah. If it's a zoning, if we're doing a floodplain bylaw change or something.
Well, I can't answer the question about where they're paid from or something, but I know Lynn gets the bills from the newspapers. She used to get the recorder sends her bills, but I don't know what account they use for them or anything.
Okay. When you guys go to work on this, the was changed so the applicant is picking up the legal ads for the site plan review in mid-March. So there's like 9 months of the fiscal year where we were last year. Right. It won't be applicable this year. But
those are all paid by the town clerk. That doesn't come through us at all, even though it's on our schedule.
So this category advertising doesn't mean anything.
Right.
For what it's worth, in the budget planning spreadsheet for the planning board, there are only two line items listed. Salaries, which I think is what presumably what we're paying Mary for her good work, and two, general expenses.
Well, if you turn to the other spreadsheet, the one that's marked BD, I think.
Oh, DB? Oh, yeah.
There, that breaks down the general.
Oh, it's broken out. Yeah, I see that. Okay. And the only other thing we've been asked is, for all kinds of understandable reasons, to try to keep our 22 budget level funded with our 21 budget.
That's basically what I've been doing for the last 12 years.
Mary, you've been paying these expenses out of pocket?
Yes.
Well, that has to stop. You shouldn't be subsidizing the town of Whately.
She is intending to file. But she...
I'll talk to Amy and see if there's anything we can do about that.
Well, she intends to be reimbursed. She just hasn't.
No, well, I have to tell you the truth.
There are no receipts, so we've got to figure out another way to do it. Period.
Well, we need a line item to start with.
Excuse me?
We need a line item to start with, to which
we've got the line item, but we have no receipts for the last 12 or 13 years. So it's a moot point at this point.
I used to hand in receipts and then
stop.
Receipts were not working out, so.
Maybe the thing to do is order your paper from W.B. Mason on the town's account.
Ah, and then have to go to town office and pick it up. But you know,
no, it could be delivered to. I don't know.
I will talk to Amy and we'll work this out. Period.
All right. I think we should move on. So then the only other item not anticipated was this issue of a tree that got cut down at the Nexam facility off Christian Lane. And you at the top of today's meeting, Don, said something that puzzled me. Actually, would it help people? Did people have a chance to look at the photos that were sent in?
I think the one important thing that we need to know is the tree was planted on the abutter's property.
You mean what? Are you asserting it was, or you're asking whether it was?
No, I think it was. Am I right, Sarah?
Yes, it was a replacement for a tree they'd taken down.
So I think we need to start with whether the owner of the property has changed and maybe they took it down.
No.
That
was still on the Cocotte property.
Okay. All right.
But it is screening the now Borowski property.
Okay.
And did the Borowskis take it down?
No.
Okay.
So I'm a little puzzled. I'm sharing this photograph that the Bechtas sent in. This stump apparently was a quote unquote screening evergreen. How whatever was on the top end of that stump could have screened anything remains a mystery to me.
You can see, Brant, can you see the gutter of the house on the very left side?
Yes.
It screens that house.
Oh, like line of sight between the utility pole.
Yes.
They just didn't like to see that utility pole.
No, this was even before the Borowskis were there. This was part of our setting this up.
I see.
It was replacing a tree that was cut to put the poles in, and we said that needed to be replaced to continue to screen that house.
I see. So do we know that?
I think the plan calls for a 10-foot hemlock. It's either 8 or 10 foot.
Did Nexam cut it down?
That's the question. Who cut it down?
So we don't know who cut it down. And the neighbor across the street basically asked us, like, what's going on? Why was this cut down? Will it be replaced? And
they are very, very conscientious of the screening of that. And anyway, I'm not going to get into neighbor stuff.
So Judy had an interesting, I thought it was a great proposal, like maybe this is a time for the planning board to send a letter, draft and send a letter. I'm not sure exactly to whom, NextAmp, whoever owns or operates this. And it seems like this is it was an opportunity to ask some questions and remind the new owners of their obligations.
This is the existing owner of the property that needs to be reminded of what screening should stay there. And NextAmp is part of that.
Okay.
This is not Borowski, this is Kokot.
Okay. So whose land is this tree?
It's close to the line, but I believe it's Kokot.
Okay, and that Kokot's the land where the facility is.
Yes.
Okay, all right.
And we don't know if the landowner cut it down?
Well, the landowner has rented this whole facility.
But the landowner maintains it, and I suspect it more likely the landowner than NextAmp.
So does the landowner have a right to cut down a tree on his property, even though it's embedded in the NextAmp conditions?
That would be interesting to know.
Well, I think NextAmp has a right to see that it maintains there. I think that's something for them to work out.
NextAmp has to maintain it, hasn't particularly maintained it well, and hasn't really complied fully with the planting scheme all along.
So this requires, and this is probably not the right forum to do this, this requires a little bit more research. We have an operations and maintenance plan for this facility, and I gave it at least one read through, and I didn't see anything in the O&M plan about maintaining any kind of landscape plantings. So I'm a little confused about whether maintaining landscaping should be in an O&M plan.
It's in the conditions. I sent you the conditions, Brandon.
And it is clearly there in the conditions.
That's our requirement. The O&M plan was written for the state.
I have my tickler list right here. Call and write a letter to SVE. So how does that work for us?
Well, I think if you can call and find out who cut it down, and then we're going to have to work out a procedure to remind all these people that they're supposed to be providing us annual reports.
Well, that's what
they're not doing.
That's what I'm going to talk to SVE about.
So that's what. Well, you have to ask NextAmp, I think.
That SVE.
SVE is the engineer behind the NextAmp facility.
Yeah.
Yep. And we do have an electronic copy now in the OneDrive folder of the as-built plan. And
I think the name is a misnomer. It's as was supposed to be built. I think to the engineer, once they've got the approvals, that's as built.
Yeah, so I think what we're talking about is...
Actually, that is as built because the other trees that are supposed to be along the Christian Lane are not there.
Yeah, and the ones on the west boundary aren't there.
Yeah.
There's and the ones on the diagonal aren't there.
Yeah, there should have been one more up near the property line on the other side of the wetlands. We called for three trees in there.
I'm sorry, where is that, Don? Up here on the western edge?
Yes.
Yeah, in this area?
Yeah, on that corner.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, Don, it seemed like you're saying you're going to reach out initially to SVE to ascertain get an explanation for why this tree was taken down?
Well, we really need to find out who took it down first.
I think that could be back on SVE because they're the ones who're supposed to be maintaining this.
Right.
Okay.
So, I mean, that would be their investigation and their argument with the whoever took it down.
Okay.
Okay, so any problems we have with the maintenance and the original plantings not being done go to SVE, and any concern about reporting goes to NEXAM.
Right.
Okay.
So do we need to write two different letters or just one letter to SVE and let them deal with NEXAM?
No, well, it's NEXAM who is the permit holder and the, so the reporting obligations are on them because it's for things like change of ownership and how the facility is working, not the landscaping.
Okay. So let me just make sure I'm sure, because I'm happy to take a shot at drafting this letter and circulating it for review and comment.
Well, the letter to NEXAM is one of many that, because we haven't gotten them from any of the facilities. And a couple of them were approved before the bylaw was passed.
Okay.
But they're at least three or four where we should be getting regular reports and we're not.
And both of those were engineered by SVE.
Okay.
And the one on the Sanderson property, I don't think that's a problem.
No, but we're not getting it. Well, that was before the bylaw was passed, wasn't it? So the ones that were since the bylaw are the two NEXAM ones and the one affiliated with Greenhouse. And we're not getting reports on any of those.
So again, I want to try to crystallize this into an action for somebody.
It's already on Hannah's list.
It sounds like there are two different letters that you need written. One, I mean, you need research done for all of the permits that you've issued throughout the past that still might have outstanding reporting, right?
Yep.
And then additionally, you have someone that's in violation of an agreement that you made with them, right? I think those are two different letters.
I agree. We have a apparent violation at the COCOT NEXAM facility around landscape screening. A tree's been cut down, and it seems like other plantings that were called for in the conditions have not been planted. Is that an accurate statement, Judy?
I think so.
Okay. And it seems like, so a letter needs to be written, and I think that letter would go to SVE for the NEXAM facility to identify these problems and request that they be remediated. So I have a question, like when there's a violation, like, well, presumably we're not taking this to the building inspector and turning this into an enforcement action.
Well, I think we owe them a complaint letter first.
All right, so it sounds but like-
The Hannah, other letter is not in the conditions, it's in the bylaw itself. It's the bylaw that requires the annual reports.
Okay.
And so everything, any of the solar facilities that were built since that bylaw was adopted need to do something. And I don't believe, Lynn, I talked to Lynn about this when she was town clerk and she thought maybe a notice reminder could go out with some something else that's sent out from the town, maybe something about the pilot agreements or something. So maybe there's a way to automate this to go in tandem with other town communications.
Okay, I think we beat this to death. Brent, you and I are going to meet. We can talk some of the stuff later.
Yeah, and let's, so Hannah, just make a note and we'll follow up with you to clarify, but it does seem like there's going to be like a complaint letter written regarding the cutting down of the tree and the lack of compliance with landscape plannings per the original site plan approval conditions. And then there's this separate issue that applies to NextSamp as well as two or three others, just about regular reporting requirements. And so Don, yeah, let's, I'll be in touch maybe tomorrow by phone and we can figure out when we can, have a party at town office.
Yeah, I'm gonna move that the meeting be adjourned.
I'll second that.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Meeting is adjourned. Thank you all.
Good night, everyone.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Hannah. Mary.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.